Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by John Swinney on community cohesion. The First Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. First Minister.
President Officer, during the summer recess, everyone was affected by the dreadful tragic deaths of three girls in Southport. On the 29th of July, Baby King, aged 6, Elsie Dot Stancom, aged 7, and Alice De Silva Agia, aged 9, who were all attending a summer dance class, were attacked and killed. My heart goes out to the families of the girls who lost their lives. No parent should have to face the loss of a child, let alone in such appalling circumstances. 10 others were seriously injured in this horrific and shocking attack. My thoughts have been with the community of Southport, who, whilst facing this unthinkable tragedy, then faced further distress. Starting in Southport and sparked by false information and rumour on social media as to the identity and background of the perpetrator of the attack, communities in England and Northern Ireland were then made to endure disorder and rioting on top of their grief and concern for those affected. This led to considerable distress to residents, significant damage caused to businesses and a number of casualties, including police officers who were injured in the line of duty. Presiding Officer, let me be clear, this activity was not and should not be classed as protest. This was violence and thuggery, pure and simple, perpetrated by those with a far-right ideology, by those who have been taken in by that rhetoric and by criminals. Far from having legitimate concerns, those indulging in these mindless acts were doing so from a place of racism, Islamophobia and anti-immigrant sentiment. This cannot and should not be tolerated anywhere. It is absolutely unacceptable for anyone to live in fear of leaving their home or to feel nervous about sending their children to school or to be afraid to use certain services or transport. Justice has been done in the English courts with sentences reflecting the serious criminality perpetrated. To date, Scotland has not had to deal with incidents of a similar nature, despite the attempts to organise these via social media. But we must continue to be vigilant against ideologies that can lead to such violence. We cannot take the view that we may be immune from related disorder occurring on our own doorsteps. Were we to see anything similar in Scotland, our courts have robust sentencing powers available to them to use as they see fit. And the Justice Secretary and I have been in regular contact with Police Scotland, who remain alert to the prospect of disorder and are working with their colleagues in other parts of the United Kingdom to ensure that they can respond accordingly and immediately if such response is required. I'm grateful to the Chief Constable and want to thank her and all in Police Scotland for their continued work and commitment in keeping our communities safe. Presiding Officer, we should rightly be proud of our history as a nation that values both free speech and welcoming those who want to live and work here. We can be proud that as a society we celebrate, value and protect diversity in our communities. But we must challenge those who would deny those values. We must guard against prejudice, discrimination and misinformation that aim to incite hatred and violence. And we must remember that those who seek to divide us are in the very small minority, and let me be clear, it is a small minority. Whilst we watched the violence unfold in communities and heard about how social media was being used to whip up the disorder and violence that several towns witnessed overnight in August, we also saw many more people in communities come together to express how this was not reflective of their towns. We saw many more people work together to clean up the mess and damage in their neighbourhoods. And we can all take heart that on the 10th of August, thousands of people took to the streets across the UK to protest against the racist thuggery and anti-immigrant rhetoric that they had witnessed. Far, far more people than had taken part in the disorder itself. Presiding Officer, our relationships with our diverse communities are crucial to community cohesion. And I know that many people felt scared or uneasy in those early days of August. Violence, prejudice, racism, Islamophobia and anti-Semitism have no place in our society and nobody should ever be subjected to them. So I want to reassure everyone impacted that this government will always work to ensure every person living in Scotland is protected, and that we are united in our opposition to anyone who would seek to use disorder as a means of division. In the first week of August, I attended the Edinburgh Central Mosque, and at my invitation, faith leaders came together as well. This provided an opportunity for us all to make clear that conflict and hatred have no place here. Faith leaders from across Scotland continue to promote mutual respect and share a common desire for everybody to be safe within our society. And as First Minister, I assured them that desire is shared by all of Scotland's political leaders. Presiding Officer, I also convene a meeting and briefing between political leaders and Police Scotland, and I thank colleagues in this chamber for taking the time to attend that event. This enabled senior office bearers to brief all of us on the work they are undertaking to keep people safe as they engage with communities to provide reassurance and ensure that none feel marginalised, isolated or vulnerable. In recent weeks, the service has had considerable engagement with Muslim and other minority communities. Greater officer visibility around mosques and hotels housing asylum seekers have also been well received. Let me be absolutely clear to anyone in Scotland considering mimicking the kind of vile behaviour we have witnessed in parts of England and Northern Ireland this summer, that their actions will not be tolerated, they will be dealt with robustly, and criminal actions online will be taken just as seriously. I want to reassure people in Scotland that we have plans and preparations in place to ensure that everybody is kept safe in this period, and that we continue to work cooperatively with our wide range of organisations throughout the country to tackle racism, hatred and to promote inclusion. Presiding Officer, let me turn now to the role of social media and how its use, or should I say misuse, has proven how easy it is for false information to spread. Following the tragic events in Southport, social media was a key factor in the first incident of disorder which then took place. In Scotland, we had an occasion where untrue speculation was spread about the perpetrator of an incident in Stirling. I wish to commend Police Scotland for their swift action in countering this misinformation, and I believe in helping to reduce the risk of any possible conflict in Scotland. While we all have an individual duty to question whether everything we read online is actually true, it is very clear to me that the major organisations behind these platforms also have a duty both moral and legal, to take action to ensure that individuals in our society are not subjected to hate and threatening behaviour, and that communities are protected from violence. I wrote to the main social media companies, asking them to promptly outline the decisive steps they plan to take on this matter, and we have engaged constructively with the United Kingdom government on this question. Social media companies have assured me that safety teams have been working to detect any associated violation of their terms of service, and that they have taken action which includes account suspension and content removal. But recent events suggest that there is much more work to do to ensure hateful content and misinformation do not proliferate. Presiding Officer, I want to conclude by emphasising to anyone who feels fearful of being targeted for who they are or what they believe that we stand in solidarity with them. Scotland is a diverse multicultural society where everyone is welcome, and I want us to be united in our opposition to anyone who would seek to use disorder and violence to divide people. However, we are not immune to the actions of a violent, misguided minority, and therefore we must remain vigilant. People in Scotland who are feeling afraid, marginalised or isolated as the result of this summer's events should rightly look to their parliamentarians to stand with them, and we do. As First Minister of Scotland, I will always be emphatic that violence and conflict have no place in our communities. The Scottish Government is committed to building cohesive communities within which divisive narratives will not resonate. It is in our power to address hatred and prejudice by tackling its root causes. The most powerful and effective way to do this is by bringing communities together to learn from one another. Standing for tolerance and equality and against hate and violence is for all of us in this chamber and across society to commit to. The importance of one Scotland, where people live in safety and peace and have the opportunity to flourish, cannot be understated. I would like to close by reflecting on the words of Sabir Zazi, Chief Executive of the Scottish Refugee Council, who was among community leaders that I met in August. Sabir emphasised the importance of nourishing community togetherness, of shared values and of the need to build bridges and bonds between communities. Presiding Officer, let us all affirm our commitment to doing just that. Bridges must be built, but they must also be maintained, and that is the approach that we should all take.
The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business, and I would be grateful if members who wish to put a question were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by saying how good it is to see Richard Lockhead back in Parliament today after his serious illness. People across Moray and obviously here in the Chamber are pleased to see him looking so well, and our thoughts are with Richard, Fiona, Angus and Fraser as he continues his recovery. Turning to the statement we've just heard, I want to echo the comments of the First Minister about the tragedy in Southport. Every parent worries about their child getting hurt, and no one can imagine the pain the families are going through right now of three precious girls who were brutally murdered in horrific circumstances at a summer dance class. It is unimaginable. And our thoughts and prayers are with the family and friends of the young victims and indeed the others injured during this senseless attack. I also want to say at this point unequivocally that everyone, regardless of faith, race and background, here in Scotland and across the UK, deserves to feel safe. Violence has no place in our society. The rioting and attacks that we saw in UK cities over the summer were both tragic and deeply alarming. And while it is welcome that these events have not occurred in Scotland, we can't be complacent and deceive ourselves that they could never happen here. We have to be prepared. But police officer numbers in Scotland have fallen by 1,000 in the last 3 years. David Threadgold, the chair of the Scottish Police Federation, has said, and I quote, "The service simply cannot recruit the number of officers it needs to replace those who are leaving." We all know the vital role that police officers play in managing disorder and keeping our communities safe. So what action is this government taking to halt the reduction in police officers across Scotland? And at this point, I remind the Chamber that my wife is a serving police officer. Also in June, before the riots occurred, this government released almost 500 inmates from prisons early because of a lack of capacity in prisons. So can the First Minister provide an update on prison capacity and whether more early releases are being considered by his government? And finally, the Home Secretary announced yesterday that the UK government will review its counter-extremism strategy. What discussion has the First Minister had with the UK government about this work?
First Minister.
Can I thank Mr Ross for his contribution and associate myself very much with his remarks in relation to my colleague Richard Lockhead, who I'm delighted to see back after a very serious illness, and I commend the staff at Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, who I had the great privilege to meet just days after Richard's operation, to thank them for the extraordinary work that they had undertaken. It puts me in awe of what clinicians have to face and to handle, and I'm profoundly grateful to them, and I'm delighted that Richard is back in his place today. In relation to some of Mr Ross makes a number of comments about the importance of community cohesion and safety and the safety of children, and I associate myself entirely with him. He is entirely correct about those. On police numbers are growing as a consequence of very significant recruitment efforts that are now underway by Police Scotland, and we expect the numbers to be rising in the period ahead. What I would say is that police capacity has been adequate and appropriate to deal with the challenges that we faced, and indeed the Chief Constable has been able to take part in mutual aid to Northern Ireland, which she would only do if she was confident about police resourcing in Scotland, and she has given me that assurance that she is. In relation to the early release of prisoners, Parliament obviously authorised the steps that we have taken so far. The prison population is continuing to rise, and to rise significantly. So the government, the cabinet, was updated on that issue by the Justice Secretary this morning. So we are having to look at the issues about capacity within our prison system, and whether there are any other steps that we have to take to ensure the prison population remains safe and sustainable for prisoners and staff. And the Justice Secretary will update Parliament about these questions. In relation to the work of the United Kingdom Government on terrorism measures, obviously we keep in regular discussion with the United Kingdom Government on these questions, and we will expect to take forward those discussions in the period ahead as the UK Government forms its steps. Mr Ross will of course be aware that we have taken a slightly different approach to the handling of these issues in terms of their communication within Scotland in the past, which have been built on building community confidence in anti-terror measures. And I've a great deal of confidence in that. And I think most importantly, the communities of Scotland have confidence in that measure, as we saw demonstrated during the course of the incident of the period of instability that we wrestled with over the summer.
Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by echoing the comments about Richard Lockhead? It's great to see him back. And can I also warmly welcome the content of the First Minister's statement today? Hearts go out to all the families in Southport, and in particular those directly impacted by those horrendous acts of violence. And tragically, when those families and that community that was hurting needed love, time and support, instead a hateful band of far-right thugs attempted to hijack those tragic murders of three young girls with the aim of further dividing our communities and spreading fear right across the country. I want to praise the response of the UK Government, which I think was strong, swift and appropriate. I also want to thank the Scottish Government and the police here in Scotland for the tone of their own response in order to minimise the risk of disorder here in Scotland. And I welcome the opportunity for us in this Parliament today to again come together and speak with one voice, that we will not allow the acts of a mindless few to speak for the vast majority in this country who believe in the principles of peace, tolerance and love. But sadly, there are those who do seek to divide our communities, and much of it amplified by reckless politicians only interested in their own divisive agendas. And we've got to call them out for what they are. But there also has to be greater responsibility on the social media companies who are allowing their platforms as vehicles to amplify, to recruit, to organise and to fundraise. There's also, of course, individual responsibility to make sure people aren't either deliberately or inadvertently sharing misinformation. We all have a responsibility to make sure we're doing everything we can to pull our country together. Because ultimately, Presiding Officer, there will always be those who want to turn community against community because they thrive on the politics of us versus them. But here in Scotland and right across the UK, we can't be complacent and must recognise our responsibility to build a society that is about all of us. So can I ask the First Minister, does he agree that we must never and will never allow the words or the actions of a mindless few far-right thugs to define who we are as a people or who we are as a nation?
First Minister.
Can I welcome Mr Sarwar's remarks, and particularly the point that he makes in relation to the interaction with social media, because there is a responsibility on all of us in what we say and what we do, but also in terms of what we believe on social media. But there is a huge obligation on the companies, and I think the United Kingdom Government has been making it pretty clear to social media companies, as have Ofcom, and Ofcom's statements at the height of these difficulties were very, very clear about the obligation of social media companies to operate within the code of responsibility. And as I indicated in my statement, I think there is much, much more to be done to ensure that is the case. I don't think we can pause for a moment to in any way, shape or form relax our rejection of the far-right ideology. I think we have got to be persistent and assertive about setting out that that represents the wrong agenda for our country, and that we have to stand together. We believe in the importance of diverse multicultural communities. We believe in the importance of bringing people together. and all of us, and I'm very pleased. I was delighted to welcome the political leaders to Bute House to enable us to have a briefing and to make the point, which colleagues did make, that we are working to create a cohesive society. We want people to come together, and we reject the ideology of the far right in politics.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Greens, can I also offer a warm welcome back to Richard Lockhead. We're very pleased to see him recovering well. And can I thank the First Minister for his statement, which properly reflected both the depth of compassion for those affected by the violence in Southport, the horrific murders, but also the depth of anger at those who have opportunistically capitalised on that horrific event in order to pursue their own toxic ideology. But can I suggest that while I welcome a lot of what was in his statement, there are two things that were missing from it. Because it's not only social media that is responsible for the promotion and proliferation of hatred and prejudice against immigrants, against asylum seekers, and against Muslims. These attitudes have also been deliberately cultivated by large swathes of the mainstream media in the UK and by successive UK governments. And politicians from a number of different parties are culpable for that. And secondly, it's when social cohesion, when community cohesion is already weakened, that the far right finds its opportunity. So can I say to the First Minister and ask him if he agrees that if more austerity is coming at us, we have a responsibility to ensure that the burden of that falls on the wealthiest, not on our communities, on the investment that they need or on the public services that they need if we want a chance of maintaining the cohesion of the communities the First Minister describes?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I acknowledge the importance of the points that Mr Harvey makes, and I thank him for his comments. I think there have been many comments made in the mainstream media and by politicians that I would never, ever, ever want to be associated with because they represent an ideology that I find repugnant, but I accept the reality that it is there, which is why it's so important that we exercise the political leadership in Scotland, that we reject that ideology and we reject it right across this parliamentary chamber. And I think that's to the credit of all parties in this parliament, that we are prepared to stand together to reject that. And I will do everything I can as First Minister to foster a climate that enables that to be the case, because I want this parliament to speak as one, that far-right ideology, that any ideology of racism or hate has absolutely no place in our society whatsoever. In relation to his point about social and economic cohesion within our communities, the government, as he will know, invests heavily to make sure that we work to tackle poverty in our society. I would like to feel I was operating in a situation where I had a more sympathetic prevailing climate to try to tackle poverty as a consequence of the change of government. I'm left somewhat bewildered by the fact that we're not making more headway on that question, but it is early days. But it's important that we recognise the damage, and this is where I do associate myself with Mr Harvey, we recognise the damage of austerity. Austerity is damaging our communities and the fabric of life. That's why it's got to come to an end. And I want to ensure that is the case in Scotland.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I too welcome Richard Lockhead back to the chamber? It's great to see him so well. Can I start by thanking the First Minister for the tone of his statement, also the inclusivity with which he approached the immediate aftermath and, well, during the riots, when he invited all political leaders to Bute House, and for the briefings we got there. Presiding Officer, when those murders happened, the four nations of these islands fell silent, and that silence was broken by the brutal thuggery we saw on the streets of England. I think, astonished, I'm sure the Chamber shares my astonishment, that some of the youngest perpetrators of that lawlessness were as young as 11 years old. Nobody is born racist, but as the First Minister says, that many people in our society are becoming more susceptible to rhetoric and online misinformation. And when it comes to young people of that age, it strikes me that we do, as a state, have a role to counter that. So I'd like to ask the First Minister what steps his government is taking to work with educational authorities to make sure that we counter that level of misinformation and rhetoric right at the heart of our schooling system.
First Minister.
President, sir, I welcome Mr Cole Hamilton's comments. He will be familiar with the ethos of Curriculum for Excellence, which is the curriculum in our schools, which one of its objectives, one of the four capacities, is to create responsible citizens. And that aspiration runs right through the curricular approach in the 3-18 curriculum that we have. So from the earliest interaction that young people have with our education system, that importance of becoming a responsible citizen is imbued into the educational model that we take forward. Very specifically on these incidents that we've had over the summer, the Chief Inspector of Education wrote to all local authorities to convey guidance and educational materials that could be utilised by the school system, obviously when the school system returned in August, to make sure that materials were available to schools to support them in the important work, which I agree with Mr Cole Hamilton, has to be taken forward to ensure that young people are exposed to the most considered material that supports them to become responsible citizens and to turn their back on any involvement in the violence and the prejudice that we saw in the streets of England and Northern Ireland.
Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Russell Findlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the First Minister's statement today. Like many places, misinformation on the nature of a recent serious incident in Stirling spread rapidly online. Can the First Minister further outline what action needs to be taken to ensure that websites such as X, Meta and TikTok combat the spread of misinformation and address racist and hateful material on their platforms? Have social media platforms provided reassurance?
Minister.
Sir, I have been in touch with social media companies and I've had responses from some of them about the steps that they take, and they provide some degree of assurance about material that is taken down. I don't think that goes nearly far enough. I think it's quite easy to view material which I consider to be completely and utterly repugnant online and to be unacceptable. Ofcom have very, very strict and clear guidelines in place. My sense is that those are not being respected by the social media companies, and we will engage in dialogue with the UK government to make sure that whatever strengthening is required to do that will be undertaken. But the social media companies have a responsibility to exercise that, and they could exercise it this minute to protect communities from being exposed to unacceptable material.
Russell Findlay to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you. I echo the sentiments raised by colleagues across the chamber. We all have a duty to stand up to bigotry and racism in all its forms. And it's important to recognise that the response to these riots showed the overwhelming tolerance and decency of people across the UK. Presiding Officer, we've already heard that police officer numbers in Scotland are at their lowest in 17 years. And today it's been reported that an additional 1,000 officers are eligible to retire in the coming year. So I'd like to ask the First Minister if he can tell us what he considers to be the minimum number of officers required to keep our communities safe.
First Minister.
Obviously, the number of police officers is an operational matter for the Chief Constable. Well, obviously, there are discussions between government and the Chief Constable about these matters and the Scottish Police Authority. But we expect, as I said to Mr Ross in my earlier answer, there has been a fall in police numbers because, actually in part driven by the issue that Mr Findlay raises, of a larger number of retirals than were expected. So, but the recruitment is underway to replace those individuals, and we expect police numbers to rise. But I do reiterate the point that we've had police numbers at the level we've had in Scotland, which I accept is lower than they have been, but we've also been able to offer mutual aid to other forces where that's been requested, and communities in Scotland have remained safe.
Rona Mackay to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's vital that we do all we can to reach out to our faith and migrant communities to offer solidarity, support and the reassurance that they enrich the social and cultural fabric of our nation. With this in mind, can the First Minister provide further detail on the work being supported to promote community cohesion across the country?
First Minister.
President Officer, there is a great deal of work underway in this respect through the dialogue we have with stakeholder organisations who are very well connected within communities. The Justice Secretary and I went to visit the Edinburgh Central Mosque during this incident, and it was reassuring to hear the comments being made by the members of the Muslim community about their relationship with the police and the dialogue that takes place. I had my own experience of that when I visited a synagogue in East Renfrewshire, and I met with the Jewish community, and I heard similarly of their appreciation of the assurance of their safety that was undertaken, although they highlighted to me the fact that they feel at times very, very unsafe and fearful. So we have to actively support that activity, and I assure Rona Mackay that that work is underway within Scotland today.
Katie Clark, to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Does the First Minister agree with me that the rise of the far right is a problem across the UK, with many in society feeling alienated and disenfranchised? What more does he think can be done to work with community organisations, trade unions and others to support groups affected, but also to combat this ideology?
First Minister.
I think there's two aspects to that. I very much agree with the aspirations that Katie Clark sets out in her question, and I think there's two points of response that I would make. One is that I think we have got relentlessly to give the political leadership about the value and the inclusivity of our communities, and not to allow anything at all to get in the way of our unity about that point. It is precious to me, and that's why I valued the engagement of political leaders over the summer. The second thing is about social and economic policy choices and frankly, about austerity. I think enormous damage has been done to our society in the last 14 years in this period of austerity, and I want it to come to an end because we need to reinvest in our communities. We need to tackle the challenge of poverty. I will say more about this in the programme for government tomorrow, because I believe that is the feeding ground of some of this misplaced ideology.
Ben McPherson, to be followed by Christine Graham.
In continually working to protect, promote and enhance community cohesion and inclusion, would the First Minister wish to further emphasise our shared admiration for the important contribution that local organisations and individuals across Scotland make to proactively, positively, tenaciously and regularly bring people together as fellow citizens and human beings, through various initiatives, communications and events, and who also work to support new Scots in our communities. Remarkable organisations like the Multicultural Family Base, the Edinburgh Interfaith Association, Building Bridges and the Welcoming here in the capital.
First Minister.
I agree very much with Ben McPherson. I think there's a whole host of community organisations that do remarkable work in bringing people together. They exist across all communities. I had a conversation with Mr Carlow during the summer about organisations that come together in his constituency to support communities which provided welcome assistance and assurance for individuals, and I would encourage them to continue to do that and to express my appreciation for all that they do.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Pam Gossel.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. On the streets of Southport were thugs, racists and all manner of extremists, but there were also people from what one might call, inverted commas, deprived areas, close commas, inverted commas, generally raging against the political establishment. Does that 60% turnout at the recent election not tell us that politics is failing when some choose bricks, not the ballot box, and that the cohesion Patrick Harvey referred to will be severely tested under increasing austerity?
First Minister.
I've made clear my point, that my view, that austerity is causing damage to our communities, and I want to see that resolved. I don't think that I cannot summon up any kind of appreciation or understanding why somebody wants to engage in violence. I just can't understand it at all. So I think it's got no justification. And political participation is an essential way to resolve any differences and debates within our society, and we should all engage in that. So I think it's important to separate out these different things. I think we should make our political choices, exercise our political leadership, and encourage people to participate in the political process, and be absolutely and completely resolute in rejecting any sense that there is any a excuse or legitimacy for violence in our society, which I know Christine Graham will, that will not be her view, and we have to set that out very clearly to ensure that the public are protected and that we invest in and support our communities.
Pam Gosnell to be followed by Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland was not exempt from the turmoil that occurred last month. While no riots broke out in Scotland, ethnic minority constituents in my region contacted me to say they felt unsafe. So unsafe that they decided to stay at home or close their businesses until tensions calmed. What action is the First Minister taking to build community cohesion, not just between civil servants and community leaders, but between members of the community? Will there be an increase in community outreach initiatives and community hubs?
First Minister.
I think it's important that we encourage and enable the cohesion of communities. Some of that comes about by political leadership, some of it comes about by community work, some of it comes about by the active investment of social and economic priorities within the government's programme and the programme of local authorities. And of course our local authorities are heavily involved in all of this work on community cohesion at local level. So it's so important that we remain focused on that. I think it's unacceptable that anybody should feel unsafe in our society. I think it's unacceptable that somebody has got to close their business because they're fearful of being attacked. That's completely repugnant to me. Police Scotland are prepared to be visible and active to protect people, and they have done so. So I think a combination of those measures, investment in our communities, effective policing and strong, clear political leadership will help us through these difficulties.
And Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Stand Up to Racism Scotland has planned a family-friendly, safely stewarded mass event with support from trade unions and civil society organisations this coming Saturday. What advice will the FM provide to people wishing to attend this rally to express solidarity with communities affected by these recent disorders and for them to stay safe?
First Minister.
So I would simply encourage people who intend to attend any such event to follow the guidance that is available, to follow any advice from the police, fundamentally to stay safe and to engage in democratic, peaceful protest. There is a place for democratic, peaceful protest in our society. I think Parliament will be familiar. I've been on a few of these myself over my time. But there's a place for democratic engagement, but it's got to be done in a peaceful fashion. And I'm sure that will be followed this weekend.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement on community cohesion. I'll allow a moment or two for front benches to organise before we move on to the next item of business.